नमः पार्वती पतये। गोविंदनाम संकीर्तनम्।
लक्ष्मी नृसिंह करुणारस स्तोत्र। प्रह्लाद नारद पराशर पुंडरीक व्यासादि भागवत पुंगव हृन्निवास भक्तानुरक्त परिपालन पारिजात लक्ष्मी नृसिंह मम देहि करावलंबम। लक्ष्मी नृसिंह मम देहि करावलंबम।
जय जय शंकर हर हर शंकर।
Yeah, namaste children, namaste parents. Now we are going to start the session today. So we are here to hear the stories of Adi Shankara. We are hearing all the stories of Adi Shankara. So we will start with the prayer as usual. Okay. Om Shuklam Varadaram Vishnum Shashivaranam Chaturbhujam प्रसन्नवदनं ध्यायेत् सर्वविघ्नोपशान्तये। गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुर्साक्षात् परब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरुवे नमः। गुरुवे सर्वलोकानां विषजे भवरोगिणां निधये सर्वविद्यानां दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। तेन्नाडुडैय पेरियवा पोत्रि एन्नाट्टवर्क्कुम् निरैवा पोत्रि சர்வஜ்ஞா சர்வவியாபி பெரியவாச்சரணம் மாயப்பிறப்பருக்கும் மகா பெரியவாடி போற்றி. சோ வெரி ஹாப்பி டு see you all here. சோ லாஸ்ட் செஷன் வி saw how ஆதிசங்கரா how he defeat மண்டன மிஸ்ரா and make him as his disciple, isn't it? He became சுரேஸ்வராச்சாரியா, isn't it? He is one of the disciple. So he became Sureshwaracharya. So we saw the defeat of Mandana Mishra there. So by conquering him in his debate and showing him how this Advaita Vedanta philosophy, isn't it, is superior than this Purva Mimamsa school. So they belong to Purva Mimamsa school, isn't it? So he debated and he conquered and he showed, he proved that Advaita Vedanta philosophy is superior to Purva Mimamsa school of thought. So he also proved his complete knowledge. So complete, he is a master of all the knowledge, isn't it? He showed even to the Saraswati by challenging Saraswati herself in debate. So and finally she gave her the blessings. So now we will see how the story continues. Okay, so debating Mandana Mishra and made him his disciple. So he became Sureshwaracharya, isn't it? So made him his disciple. He traveled south to continue his conquest, because his conquest of defeating all, he traveled, you know, all the, he defeated all the propounders of all the other philosophies, all the different schools of philosophies, and who were criticizing all the Vedas and scriptures, and you know, they are not aware of the highest truth. So he conquered all the other different school of thoughts, and to show that, to show how this Vedanta is, this Advaitic Vedanta is the highest teaching. That is, it's supreme of all the teachings. And he went and traveled the whole country, you know, debating with all the different teachers and different scholars. So after defeating you know, he was traveling towards south. He was coming towards south, and he was coming towards south with all the disciples, with this Sureshwaracharya. Sureshwaracharya is also called as, somebody can tell me, he's also called as
Mandana Mishra.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, he is also called Vartikakara, because Vartikakara means he gave most of the explanations he has given to the Bhashyam of Adi Shankara's. He has given all the explanations. So he is also called Vartikakara. So he became one of the chief disciple of Adi Shankara because of his great learning. So now Adi Shankara, what happened? along with all the disciples, he travels south through the forest and through the mountain ranges and pass through the Maharashtra until they reach a holy place called Sri Sailam. Sri Sailam is a holy place. So it is said that there is a beautiful forest there. A lot of, you know, peaks of mountains, and they say that that place is very, very, very dear to Lord Shiva. It was very dear to Lord Shiva. So this is a very famous, there is a very famous Shivalingam, Shiva temple there. And there is a holy river. And Adi Shankara took bath there. They climbed a mountain and had the darshan of that Shivalingam. Like Shiva temple. That's Shivalingam. Mallikarjuna. That Shivalingam is called Mallikarjuna. So he did puja there and stayed there for shared the knowledge with all the local scholars. So they debated with all the local scholars. There it is said Sureshwaracharya defeated some of the Shaiva and Vaishnava scholars there. In debate, because he was so learned, isn't he? So learned, Sureshwaracharya is so learned. So he took care of the debates where Adi Shankara did not need to do it himself. So those who are defeated, in the debate, and they, you know, without any pride, they joined as the disciples of Adi Shankara. But there are some. Who are so proud and so egoistic. So they resented. So they never want to join Adi Shankara. Okay, they were waiting. They are waiting for the time where they can defeat Adi Shankara. So here in Sri Sailam, an interesting thing happened there. What happened is now one day, when Adi Shankara was resting in the ashram, scary looking and evil Kapalika means like it's in like an agori. He's like one, you know, who garlands himself with bones, and they may even drink, you know, with the skulls of human skulls, you know, they may drink from the human skulls, and all these things they will do. Okay, so he approached Acharya with evil intentions. He was a very evil man. So, but what happened is he disguised himself as an ascetic, as a monk, as a sadhu, you know, just, you know, as you know, in Ramayanam, you know, you can see that Ravana has done to Sita, isn't it? He tricked by disguising himself as a sadhu and kidnapped Sita from Rama, isn't it? Just like that, he pretend to be a sadhu. This Kapalika, he pretend to be a sadhu, a holy man. And he thought, okay, the Acharya is now alone, all alone. He's all alone. And his disciples or the students are not here. They are gone for doing their daily rituals or sadhanas. They went somewhere. So now the Acharya is alone now. So he quickly went to Acharya and told him directly what he wanted. He said, I have heard about, you know, so much about you. I have heard so much about your life, your great qualities, and you are a very famous teacher. You are very famous, and you are said to be omniscient. You are said to be very omniscient with all the knowledge. So you are so merciful. You are so compassionate, like that. He was praising him. And then he said, see, great man as you are, is someone who grants whatever when someone surrenders or bow to them, isn't it? So what is asked is given to them. What is asked is given to them. So great men like you should give that. Men like you are known to be like that, okay? So, but I am very sad because, you know, I am not yet at your level. So I have my desires, small things. I performed austerities, you know, tapas for 100 years to get a boon, a wish fulfilled from Lord Shiva. So it is said that finally Shiva appeared to me. Finally Shiva appeared to me, and my wish was that I want to go to Kailasa. I want to go to Kailasa, the abode of Shiva, but in the physical human body, but with this physical human body. I want to go there with this physical body and enjoy all the blessings of that place and experience that Kailasam and everything like that with the body itself, with the body, physical body itself. So I asked this boon to Shiva, but Shiva told, I can't give this boon to you. I can't give this boon because, you know, you have to do a special kind of sacrifice. This is very extraordinary. This is a very extraordinary wish. Because, you know, where normally it's not possible for anybody to go to Kailasha with the human body. So nobody will. So it requires a special sacrifice. So that special sacrifice is that there in the fire, you need to offer your head. You need to offer the head. Sorry, you need to offer the head of either a crowned king. A crowned king. That's a ruling king. Or if you can't get the head of a ruling king, you have to offer the head of a sannyasi or an omniscient person, all-knowing person. So the Kapalika said, I have tried this. I can't get this. So I have tried for all the king's head and for all the, you know, person who are, you are my only hope. So you are, can you please help me? Wow. See, he said, you are anyway beyond the body consciousness, okay? You said that you are an Advaitic philosophy. You are anyway beyond the body consciousness. You are not worried about your physical body.
I don't, you said you would make me crap.
You are pervading your
crap.
Consciousness. You are all pervading consciousness. So nothing can happen to you. So please.
Okay, can I just have regular kumtanyar?
Please give me your head. And he said all the logic. He explained all the logic and he said that you'll become famous. When you are selfless, then you'll become famous. You'll be considered as a great person. So if you, it's a kind of win-win situation where, you know, I will get my desire and you will also become famous. So there is for you, there is no problem because, you know that the body is perishable and, you know, that, but the teachers and masters of our school, that is the Kapalika school, they say that if you sacrifice the head of a pure person like you, like yourself, you know, all the desires will get fulfilled. So, but it's very rare to find a person who is pure throughout their life. So now I found you. Okay, please be gracious. Okay, please be gracious enough to give your head. And he prostrated in front of Adi Shankara. So Adi Shankara, full of mercy, he smilingly said, okay, see, you have made a good case. Okay, you have made a good case. Okay, I will grant you your wish. Okay, there is nothing wrong in your wish and all your logic is right. So, but I cannot give my head publicly, okay? Because if my disciples, if my students, okay, find out that they will never allow me because they look up at me, okay? They consider me as a savior. So he said, we have to do this very secretively, okay? Secretly. So I will go to a solitary spot, okay? I'll go to a solitary spot. And I'll go into the state of samadhi and you come and you take off my head, okay? Take off my head and they fixed a date. And the Kapalika was very happy. Okay, yes, I got my plan now, okay? I have succeeded in getting his head, okay? I'm going to take off his head now. He's an evil person. All this, the whole story, whatever he made is also, you know, it's a kind of excuse only. So the date has come. The date has come and the Kapalika arrived there. Now he has arrived with this ceremonial dress, like armed with a trident and a sword in one hand, fully drunk. The eyes were rolling, completely intoxicated, and he was wearing garlands of bones and was also having a sword in order to cut the head, okay? So when all the disciples left them, you know, all the disciples left the ashram to do their daily rituals, Adi Shankara quietly went to the secluded spot outside the ashram and somewhere, and seeing that Kapalika has come, isn't it? He prepared himself to leave the body. And he went into the samadhi. That is, he went into the state of nirvikalpa samadhi. That's called nirvikalpa samadhi. Now he was unaware of his surroundings. He sat on samadhi. Now the Kapalika came there with a big sword, the trident in his left hand, and the sword in order to cut Acharya's head. Isn't it? At that moment, the Padmapada, his disciple, one of his disciples is Padmapada, isn't it? He who was so devoted to, Adi Shankara, he was, he saw what happened in his mind's eye, like his intuition. His intuition was so pure that his whole focus is always on Acharya. He always focuses on Acharya only, isn't it? In his master, that is Acharya, Guru only. So in his intuition, he saw that Kapalika standing with the sword and was ready to cut Adi Shankara's head, Acharya's head. He also saw intuitively the notion of the Kapalika. See, the notion that Kapalika was an evil person, isn't it? And it is said that that very moment, all the personality of this Padmapada was standing there with his intuitive mind. All the personality transforms at that very moment into a destructive wildfire. It busted. It is told that the Padmapada has attained Siddhi. In the meditation, in the mantra of Narasimha. You all know the Swami Narasimha Murthy, isn't it? The avatar of Narayana himself, who will always, remove the sufferings of all the people who are devoted him. In the story of Prahallada, you have heard about the story of Prahallada. For those who know the story, where the Prahallada was so devoted and prayed to Narayana, and the Narayana appeared in the form of Narasimha. Okay, Narasimha, the mantra was alive in him. That Narasimha mantra was alive in him, was alive in Padmapada. So this, because of this mantra siddhi and the consciousness, so that the moment and the consciousness of Narasimha took possession of Padmapada. And for a moment, what happened for that moment, he transformed into Narasimha himself. Okay. So the human personality went to sleep. And due to the ferocity of this Narasimha Murthy is so ferocious, isn't it? It's a lion-headed, but the human form with a lion head, Murthy. Isn't it? He was so ferocious. Because of the ferocity of the Narasimha, he leaped into the sky. He jumped into the sky. And he could see that Narasimha manifest there so... was roared so loudly, he was roaring so loudly that all the beings, all the animals, birds, including even the gods, they became so scared. And it was so powerful and scary that it is said that he moved, this Padmapada in the form of Narasimha, he moved so fast with speed and vigor, and in his movement, he stunned over with the speed and vigor, and got, everybody was seeing what was happening here. Even the God was seeing, what was happening. In the flash of the moment, he reached the place where the Kapalika was, about to cut down, bend down the sword to cut off the head of Acharya. And in that anger and ferocity, it is said, Padmapada, in the form of Narasimha, tore open the chest of the Kapalika, just as the Narasimha did once, to Hiranyakashipu. So he, with his nails, what he done, he tore open the chest, and with his mouth and teeth, he lifted the body and roared. There was so much, you know, anger on the roaring, and there's all the disciples, you know, they heard. They were outside, isn't it? So they heard, and they came and saw that Acharya is in the Samadhi state, and next to him was, that is, next to him, the Narasimha was standing, and next to there, you know, the corpse of Kapalika was there. They saw everything, the terrible form of Lord Narasimha. They could see the terrible form of Narasimha in the presence. You know, how could you invoke Narasimha? See, everybody was stunned to see that, you know, Adi Shankara, even they, he is in the Samadhi state. You know, he felt the presence of Narasimha. He felt the presence of Narasimha, and he woke up from the Samadhi state. He chanted a beautiful hymn to praise him, to praise Narasimha. You know, how you came to rescue me. See, you are the Lord who have come to rescue me. And so, please now become peaceful again. Okay, calm down, peaceful again. So, Narasimha became peaceful. Narasimha became peaceful, and the consciousness of Narasimha left. And Padmapada was again awakened. He was awakened to his usual state. He was awakened, and he woke up as if from a sleep. He woke up. Padmapada woke up and fell into the Acharya's feet. And this is how, you know, Kapalika was stopped from his evil plans. But now Acharya asked Padmapada, how this has happened? How? You know, as if he doesn't know. He knows everything. Acharya is a god himself, Parameshwara himself. You know, he knows everything. But he, just like that, he asks. He doesn't know. He wanted to know from Padmapada's mouth, isn't it? So Padmapada started thinking. This is a flashback of his story. Padmapada started thinking, and he was telling, like, when he was Sanandana, he was before he was called Sanandana, isn't it? Padmapada was before he was called Sanandana, isn't it? He was from the Chola kingdom, and he was called Sanandana. So years back, when he was Sanandana himself, he got initiated with Narasimha mantra. Narasimha mantra from a Brahmin. So Sanandana started meditating on this Narasimha mantra to get the darshan of Narasimha himself, Narasimha Murthy himself, Lakshmi Narasimha Murthy himself. So what happened is, he wanted to recite the mantra in a serene place, in a quiet place. So he went, he reached a place called Ahobilam. That place was a forest. So he thought that it would be appropriate to meditate there. So he sat under a tree and started meditating on Narasimha mantra. After some time, you know, he heard someone calling him. So he got distracted. Oh, what is this? He got distracted and saw a hunter, Vedan. Okay, hunter standing with a bow and arrow, you know, standing in front of him and calling. He said, Sanandara opened his eyes, and the hunter asked him, have you seen any deer here, going here? Sanandara said, no, I haven't, he said. So I was closing my eyes. I couldn't see, and I'm not aware of that. How could I see that? So he said, well, why do you close your eyes? Why are you sitting here closing your eyes? He said, Sanandana said, I was meditating. This hunter is a common man, isn't it? So he asked, what is that meditation? What is meant by meditation? What is that meditating? So Sanandana thought, how could I explain to him? So he tried to explain in his own way, hunter's way. He said that he's also this is also a type of search of an animal. This is also a type of search of an animal. Okay. At that time, he was thinking, the Sanandana was thinking about Narasimha only, because Narasimha Swami inside. So he knew not that Narasimha Swami is it's a kind of animal only, you know. So now the hunter laughed. He said, how could you search sitting at one place and that too closing your eyes? Are you joking? How could you find this? Sanandana said, no, this is a weird animal. This is not a common animal. Okay, this is a weird animal, and you have to search like this only. Sanandana thought he would go. Okay, after telling this, he would go. But this hunter, he became so curious. He wanted to know about that animal. He said, I know all kinds of animal here. You know, all kind of animals, some that live here. You just describe that animal, okay? I could bring it. Sanandan had thought, oh my God, what a disturbance here again. I wanted to meditate on Narasimha, but this fellow is not, leaving me to meditate. Okay, that animal, see, I can describe that animal. That animal would look like a human being, but with a lion's face. So the hunter laughed again. Oh, said, there is no such animal, sir, here. There is no such animal here. Somebody has fooled you. Okay, but Sanandana said, emphatically, that it is there. Yeah, there is an animal like this. So the hunter said, okay, I will challenge you. Okay, one cannot, search anything sitting here and closing your eyes. You have to go and search. So, okay, what you do, you do what you do, okay, what you want. But I will go and search and bring that animal to you before sunset, okay? So Sanandana now smilingly, he thought and he smilingly said, this is not as easy as you think. As easy to bring this Narasimha to in front of, him. But the hunter, challenged him and went away in search of Narasimha. Okay, he was completely immersed in the thought of Narasimha, completely focused in the swarupam of Narasimha, that is the lion's head with the human body. Isn't it? He was chanting Narasimha, he was thinking and he was always focused completely on it. So the sun started to set. The hunter became so upset. The hunter was so upset. He was so sad. He wanted to, even commit suicide because he doesn't know what to do, and he wanted to commit suicide. He thought he should not live anymore without finding that animal. Okay. At that time, suddenly he heard a roaring sound. He saw, to his surprise, that he could see Narasimha, like his, with a human form and with the lion head. He was standing nearby. The hunter was so happy, became so happy. He was initially scared to go near that animal because it was so different, isn't it? But it was so, Narasimha stood like a pet animal. So what happened is he could tie that Narasimha with a rope, and he brought him happily in front of Sanandana. Sanandana was sitting his place. He told him, hey, look here. See who is here. See, you can't find a thing sitting and closing your eyes at one place. I brought him. I brought this Narasimha here. Come on, see. Come on, open your eyes and see here. Sanandana was shocked because he could see nothing, but he could see the rope in the space. He could, the tied rope in the space, it was standing like that. And he could hear the roaring sound of Narasimha, roaring. Then what happened? Tears were falling. And Sanandana told, why couldn't I have darshan? When a hunter could easily see you, so Narasimha told the whole day without even thinking of a drop of water, he was focusing on me. He was completely focusing on me. He was thinking of me. He was without even taking water. So I gave darshan. So you thought, how could a hunter can get a darshan? So that is not the case. I am called Bhakta Paradhinan. Bhakta Paradhinan means whomsoever, irrespective of the caste, creed or anything, if they completely focus on me without any distraction, I will definitely come to them. I will definitely give darshan to them. So you will also definitely have my darshan, but I will come to you at an appropriate time, now the time has come. Now this time, at this time, Padmapada had the darshan. Not only had the darshan, because he himself has become Narasimha, and he could save the life of Acharya. Padmapada was taken over by Narasimha, isn't it? And he could save the life of Acharya. So now he described everything and he fell on Acharya's feet. This is how the story goes. So we can see all the stories, all the other stories also after in the next session, how other disciples have come. So we'll close this session with this much. We close with Purnamadam, and next time we'll see, okay, with all other interesting stories of Adi Shankara. Okay. पूर्णमद पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ओम शांति शांति शांति। थैंक यू ऑल। थैंक यू।
राम राम।
राम राम।
थैंक यू। राम राम।
राम राम।
राम राम।